So when you're working with a dog, say in 2 weeks, and it's going really good, healing really nice, and now you see the problems the owner's talking about, because I haven't seen it with him, very leash reactive with other dogs. Okay, so if the dog wasn't showing that before and is doing really well, then all of a sudden goes after a dog, I mean, at what point would you, I mean, I always was taught to correct right when you see him stare at the dog, you snap him out of it.
Sure.
Don't wait until he's already going after the dog.
Yeah, right? I mean, so well, what's your question exactly?
I guess. I was like, when would you correct and how would you handle that situation?
Leash reactivity can be a big topic. What's important to understand is that typically you're only going to see that behavior for two main reasons. One of them is really like 95% of the dogs are going to come to you, and that's insecurity. And then there's going to be a smaller percentage of dogs that have what we call frustration intolerance. They've never learned how to deal with the fact that they can't do everything in life they want to do, and so they see a dog, they really want to go say hi to that dog, and they get really pumped up about it. The leash is creating a barrier, creates a ton of frustration, and they just start firing up. And it looks really aggressive, but it's not. They're just frustrated, right? Maybe they're aggressive at the leash. Like they hate the leash because that's what's holding them back. Regardless, the vast majority of reactive dogs are fearful and insecure. It does not look that way though when you see them. So when we're dealing with leash reactivity, we typically want to address it right away. If a dog is really bad, then, you know, even like in our hands, in our training center, it's going to see dogs and light up. We're going to want to find some type of correction to interrupt that behavior so we can get a foundation going. And oftentimes the correction that works most efficiently for that is the pet convincer. If you're familiar with the pet convincer, it's just compressed air for anybody who's not familiar with it. Really, really handy tool. It can be a very high level aversive to a lot of dogs, so you have to be careful with it. Dogs can redirect off it, although it's not common. But it's, for whatever reason, it works really well to interrupt some of those more frantic, panicky states. Much better than a prong collar correction or a remote collar correction, and I don't know precisely why. I think it's partly the sound of it, and then also the touch that they feel from it. It's probably extremely strange to the dog, and so the novelty of it probably works to our advantage as well. Typically, what we do is we get a really nice foundation with the dog, with our leash work, and then we'll start to work the dog around other dogs. And what we're looking for right off the bat is what we call a cutoff cue, or a cutoff signal. And the cutoff signal is basically like a dog's way of saying, I'm not into that. Like, I don't want to engage, I don't want to interact. Where I believe most reactivity comes from, and the reason that there's so many dogs who are highly reactive on leash, yet can go to doggy daycare and have no problem at all, is the fact that probably at some point in their development, they're walking down the street with their human, and they're on a leash, and they see another dog, and maybe they're at a stage in their life where other dogs are a little bit frightening to them, or they're a little bit insecure about it, and so they start doing things that in normal dog communication would be a way of saying, hey, you know, not now, I need space. So cutoff signals often are going to be some form of the dog engaging with the other animal, you know, visually and attentively, and then suddenly disengaging. You can see it with things like sometimes they'll just randomly start sniffing, even when there's not really anything interesting to sniff there. Usually it's, you know, oh, here's a dog, oh, I'm not interested, and they look away and pretend they're busy, and often you can see it in their body language. But what probably happens is somewhere along these dogs' development is they're walking down the street, they're on a leash with their human. The human's not watching for those things, so they're just going forward. There's a dog that, Fido over here starts doing all this stuff that normally would be, like, effective communication with his own species. But because both dogs are attached to leashes and the humans are bringing them forward, the dogs can't disengage from each other. They just keep getting closer. And then that probably happens repeatedly, and the stress levels, keep rising, and the dog gets frustrated that they can't effectively communicate what they need. And then eventually they hit their threshold and they pop. or it's just experimentation. They say, well, all this other stuff isn't working. How about this? Bah! And they bark, right? And then what do we do as humans? Everybody pulls their dogs away, right? So the dog goes, aha! I figured it out. When I'm on a leash, the way to get space when I need it and the way to not have to interact or get closer to this dog is to scream and yell about it, right? It becomes a really effective strategy for them. Nobody brings their dog closer to you when the dog's acting like a piranha on the leash. So it's working for them. And because it works for them reliably, the behavior gets stronger. It has a very strong reinforcement schedule, right? You know, typically my solution to dealing with reactivity, it really has very little to do with correction, only in so much that I might have to correct a dog if they've completely abandoned cutoff signals. And that happens with a lot of older dogs. I mean, you can be watching as acutely as you want, and you're not going to see anything because the dog has completely abandoned that strategy. They just dive right into what's been working for them. And they really don't want to get to that dog. That's not their intention. What they're doing is they're pushing the dog away, right? Or they're getting you to move them away. So if the dog will show cutoff cues right away, then our strategy is to try and recognize the most subtle cues that we can. And when we see the dog doing that, we go, oh, no problem, dude. Let's go over here then, right? We start showing the dog that they can have room if they need it. And there's a really polite way to communicate that that's not stressful, right? And so as the dogs learn that, they start feeling more comfortable. When an animal knows they can end a situation easily, they start to allow that situation to progress maybe further than they would have before. It's no different than us human beings. And I'll give you a couple concrete examples of this in a second. So that's what we're looking for. You know, we're looking for cutoff cues. We want to show the dog that cutoff cues work, and the reward for offering a cutoff cue is that we give them space. That's their primary reinforcer in that moment, right? Is that we give them room. So we'll either take them away from the dog or we'll walk like a bubble around the dog or whatever.